opioid, drug, and alcohol issues. You've been at the forefront in Anadyomo High School, Affluent Recovery School. So Willie, Gavin Foundation, so he went to 9/11, as a lot of Boston firefighters did on that day. The minute that the incident occurred, they got in the car, they went down there, all of them. And he did the bereavement for all families. And they were there for many, many days. And it's a very, very difficult job. My sister, when she looked in her life as a hospice nurse, and it's similar, just to be confronted with that tragedy and then be able to meet with these people. Again, Willie wouldn't tell you that. So I can speak, I know him, Willie and Pat and others. I was fortunate enough when they came to me to ask if I could help them. It was easily done. I mean, these guys are heroes. These guys, put their lives on the line. And over the years, Willie has sent me people, firefighters who perhaps had a little problem. And so it's been my pleasure to be involved in that regard. But again, Willie wouldn't tell you that, and Pat wouldn't tell you that. But he's been a dear friend, great source of advice to me. And again, and these guys over here, they all help people. All they do is help people. And it's a special person.
Mm-hmm. We lost 340 firefighters that day.
Yes.
And how many workers were on the other day? How many of them affected even today?
Yes.
Would they have inhaled and everything, So thank you for that. You talk about what the challenges are in the courthouse, and we do know. There's diminished resources and facilities, and I've talked over and over about this, that we have legislators not very responsive to the needs of the judiciary, and they only give 1% to that to the judiciary budget. And I want to talk to Judge Ginsburg too, and I don't know how you change it, but you were the first one. Bring this up all the time. I say, what will you do as a judge? Do you have it in your resume that you would lobby the legislature for more secure treatment centers? And I've been saying that over and over, really sick and redundant. And you're the first one to put it in your resume, because I've said it over and over that, it's one thing to pass legislation, but, the drug addiction. We have no real center. Who's the point? And I know, because I've been to it, and they don't want to go to Dilorati. They don't want to go to the prison or the treatment center in their own house. And so I thank you for that, because you just said you're going to do that right here before we ask you. That's a big problem. And that even the Industrial Action Board, if you can imagine, they have commission on it. Now, they didn't have to deal with that 3 years ago. Yeah, and work is coming that is addicted. So they have to learn how to deal with this and get the services that they need. Thank you for that. I really appreciate that. What I'm impressed with? That you talk about reading Latin and Greek and studying Italian. It's made me feel very dumb. Doing that, I'm speaking English. But anyway, and the other thing is, I always look for what you think are the most important things, for a judge. And you said public safety, and that has to be number one. Public safety before anything else. So I really like that. What would you say is the most rewarding case, the result of the case that you can look at?
Well, I've been around 30 years, generally around the criminal side, but there's a case I think I have in my application, and this meant a lot to me because this goes to show you kind of what it means to be a lawyer. So I work at Morrison Mahoney Miller, and Morrison Mahoney Miller is an insurance defense firm. So we pretty much defend people who get sued, big corporations. I was doing professional liability. But at the time, Morrison was expanding, and we had gotten a random office. in Rainham, was it the Crossroads, I forget the Route 44 or whatever. So this woman came in and she, her husband had died, and she had an insurance policy. It was a $300,000 insurance policy. And when she made the claim after her husband died, they denied coverage, stating that he had made a material misrepresentation in the policy. So she was devastated, obviously. And the reason they said that the material misrepresentation was that he, I guess it struggled with alcoholism his whole life. On and off would be sober, and then he wouldn't be. And he had suffered seizures on occasion back and forth. That's kind of the background. So they denied it, saying he lied on his policy. So she's devastated. She just lost her husband. She doesn't have the money. So she came to Morrison, which was odd, because that's really not what we did. But I was new, and they gave me the case. I don't know why they gave it to me, but they did. And they said, why don't you look at this and see if you can do anything with it? And I had been kind of around those issues for a while, and I started to read the language in the report, in the application for insurance, and a lot of the questions were compound questions. You know, so instead of saying, are you presently receiving help for alcohol? The question would be, are you presently, or have you ever received help for alcohol or seizures, something like that? So it's a compound question. So he was answering it truthfully, because at that time he wasn't having seizures and he wasn't struggling with alcohol. So the bottom line was, I write this coverage opinion for about 5 or 6 pages, and I mail it off expecting nothing. And about 3 weeks later, I get a check for $300,000. And when I presented that check to her, you thought I cried today. She was the loveliest woman, and she was so happy. Not if the money mattered, I'm sure, but it was that the dignity of her husband was restored, and that the idea that he had lied or was an alcoholic, you know, that we got around him, and you could just see she was so proud of her husband, and she was so proud, you know, to defend his honor. So, I mean, that was, made me feel good. I mean, that was one of the few that I could honestly say I changed someone's life, you know, positive. Yeah.
Is the one that you look back on that?
There's a lot of cases on the criminal side where, and these guys know because a lot of us do criminal work, it's not so much you lose, but sometimes you get boxed in by a minimum mandatory, or you get boxed in by maybe a prosecutor who, they won't really reduce something, and we're stuck, because if we go to trial, I mean, we're going home at night, but if I lose that case, this gentleman might not go home for 2 years. And sometimes you bite your lip and you have to take a plea that you would prefer not to. I mean, you would have to sell it to this person to keep your freedom and to keep them out, you know, obviously out of jail. So there's, that happens occasionally where you just, you know, you just, you want to go to trial, but again, it's not my call, it's a client's trial. So there's frustration there. School zone kind of cases, that there's a lot of them where it may be seizures that are on, that they're overcharged. And, you know, if we go to trial and we lose, they go to jail for 2 years and a day. And they'll reduce the school zone, and my client will have to take a plea for 2 years, suspended for 2 years. So those kind of cases are frustrating. I mean, nothing, I don't remember a case where I thought, you know, the person should win and they lost and went to jail. But there's a lot of those type cases.
You know what, you just answered a question that I didn't even ask you, because I always ask, do you believe this legislation interferes with the discretion?
Well, obviously, minimum mandatory.
Minimum, yes. And the other thing is, the school, and I just talked about this, and I need to come to it, but it's coming out, but it is, that is a big difference to change. One side, and you which is drugs and all his life, and it could have been involved in crime all the life. And then you get someone, you know, 17 that, you know, just being a stupid thing to please an old friend. And that's all we did, you know? But do you see some other legislation that, that has interfered with discretion that you've dealt with?
No. I mean, minimum mandatory is definitely. Yeah, I mean, there's a lot of cases in the district court. I'll give you an example, maybe. In the old days, people would, and I say that back in like 1970, 60, 70, you would get arrested for a drunk driving. So you'd go into court and there'd be a $25 fine, you plead guilty and you're left. And then, you know, 20 years later, you got a guilty $25 fine, so you have two of them. Now you're 58 years old, you haven't been in trouble in 40 years, you get an OUI. It's an OUI third. If you lose, you go to jail for 150 days. So that type of statute, you know, really is difficult. And sometimes the district attorney, you can't work it out. You have a person 57 years old with a family and a job. They made a bad mistake, no accident, and no one really got hurt. But it's an OUI third, but the look back is knowing you. So those types of cases are out there, and they're frustrating, obviously, to the client, but obviously to us as attorneys, because our hands are tied, the law is strict, and you have to follow it. And it's not necessarily the result that really we should have.
But see, I think sometimes this legislation is passed in the inventory. It's a feel-good legislation. It's a legislative thing. I'm showing them on top. And it's just the opposite. It's really, they're looking to change that. And I have a senator in my district. I have five districts. And who's going to vote it? No. And they do not. Because it takes courage not to be able to stand. You have to go around and do what you feel is right. You have to get it. You get it. So now they're having to go and they're trying to change it. But you know, when you talk about, the demeanor, the difference between a felony and a misdemeanor, that really baffles me. And it's all about the levels. Can you explain that?
Well, from my understanding, the difference between a felony and a misdemeanor is a misdemeanor. I mean, a felony, a misdemeanor is you only do house time. You would not go to state prison. And if the judge has state prison, and then his fees along with that too. But, you know, most of the cases in the district court are, you know, misdemeanors, and there are. So, I mean, what I would be dealing with hopefully would be most misdemeanors. But it's the difference between being convicted and going to the House of Correction, you know, South Bay, say, versus going to Walpole or Shirley. So, you know, that's the difference.
Well, I have to tell you, I do like to see more criminal experiences. Yeah. My own opinion, for what it's worth, I think I'm in a civil law advantage, but any criminal. And the thing that I'm concerned about for a criminal, if you've never been an attorney in criminal cases, you'd be very timid to give the correct sentence. Is it?
Well, as it relates to me, I mean, I've been doing criminal work for 25 years. I've done court-appointed work for 20 years. My pal Jack Allen over there would tell you, because he's been with me all 20 years, that we probably get 200 or 300 cases a year. That's probably 6,000 court-appointed cases I've done over 20 years. So whether it's a plea or trials, or just being in the courtroom, seeing people like Lauren and Judge George's acting, you learn a lot. Being around.
So yeah. I remember being with you, and you had told me 6,000 cases just in some of the Superior Court thing. So, I mean, it just blew my mind.
Yeah, I didn't have 6,000 trials, but just being involved.
But the other thing, as a district attorney is offered, you get 20 or 30 a day.
Sure.
I mean, let's be realistic.
Sure.
So, you know, that if, you know, you have to have experience. And, you know, tax qualification. But the thing that is, I found with you is, some with a disability. Some disabilities are invisible. I mean, it could be, you know, autism, whatever. When you have someone that you're not familiar with it, but they tell you what the disability is, how do you proceed with that person? What is your priority when this person comes before you? Whatever.
This is a great, actually, John may remember this. This is a civil case. We had a gentleman, I'm going to forget this because it broke my heart, but he was up in the end over, and he had, well, we didn't know him, and he jumped off. The train came into the station, and he didn't know how to get off the train, and he panicked, and there was no one on the train, and he didn't know what door to get off, and he got all discombobulated, and at some point, he just jumped off the train and he like broke his leg. So we get the case. It's like, okay, I jumped off the train. We're not liable for that. And he hurt himself. But as we found out more about the case, or as I found out more about the case, and I forget exactly what it was. It was Asperger's. He had Asperger's. So he looks normal, totally normal. But there's a part of Asperger's where you can get really flustered and discombobulated. So he didn't know. So when we found that out, just like the case John mentioned before with the elderly lady, if we go to court in a cold heart and say, we're gonna just prosecute this case just on these facts, you know, we should probably win. If the jury goes, you know, what did the teacher want? They didn't do anything wrong. The guy jumped off the train and broke his leg. But we didn't do that. And John and I, we've done a whole bunch of these where we try to sit down and look at the human side of it. And this man had this disease. We didn't know, once we realized it, we resolved the case that was fair to him. He's a citizen in that he's a citizen of Massachusetts too. And we try to do the right thing by that. Counsel Ferraro mentioned that Sarah Worley was back there, and we've mediated many cases with Sarah. And that's our intent. We really try to help if we can. I mean, we just don't give money away, and we try to help. And if we can do the right thing and get to the right result, that's fair. So that's an example that on the civil side that I do remember where we tried to really see through that.
That's a priority. I served 22 years on the commission with disabilities. And it is a matter of disabilities. And I can get into it. We do very sick. So I think that judges have to have an ability to see what the disability first before we just, you know, just put them away.
Municipal court. I mean, I'm in the other courts too, but I can speak, and Judge George knows this because he's in Dorchester. Dorchester is very busy, obviously. Roxbury is very busy. Central is very busy. The rest of them, maybe not so busy, but we're all against, and I'm against. I'm a neighborhood guy. I think there should be a court in every neighborhood. I think Council Juve will agree with that too. And there's a lot of reasons you want neighborhood courts. People can get restraining orders. People can walk in and get justice quickly, Section 35s, that type of stuff. And I know that you're up in Gloucester area, and
our police stations in our court.
Exactly. And so, you know, a lot of places, if you don't have a community court, you're talking about going from, I don't know, Somerset to, you know, to Brockton or something. And so, to me personally, yeah, I understand from a financial point of view, it may make sense for or whomever decides those issues, that you can close four or five, consolidate, put everyone at the BMC, put everyone at Dorchester, Roxbury. But personally, I'm against it. If you're asking my opinion, I would like to keep the community courts open. I think it's very important. The judge in South Boston, the judges in these little towns, East Boston, they have in Gloucester or wherever, they Lynn, they have huge impact in the community. Huge impact on the community, and the judge who sits there has a huge impact on the community. And he has a lot to say what goes on in that community. I know in South Boston for years we had certain judges there a long time, and they have an influence what goes on in that community. And they get to know the community, and they get to work with the people in the community. So I'm a big proponent of community courts. Love them. I'd love to keep them. I understand there's budgetary issues. I have my vote. Keep community
courts. Yeah, I'd like you to keep advocating. As I've said many times, courts aren't in the business of making money. Courts are in the business of administering justice. And it's an access to justice issue, actually, at the community. We had a great infrastructure in the state where people could just hop on a quick car, subway, or reliable bus and get to court. You know,
Now, that would be one thing, but we don't have that. And so, you know, that's one piece of it. So we literally don't even have the access to it. But the other piece of it is exactly what you just said, that I think is so important. And it's one of the reasons why Judge George's is so important, where he sits, is because you can have a very old-fashioned influence in a part of Americana that we're losing very rapidly, of being a leader in the community and someone that, you know, as elected officials and as judges, and, you know, there's always a million people pig-piling on and telling us that we're just terrible and everything else, but you do have the opportunity to be a leader and to mentor and to help and to change the trajectory of people's lives while you sit on that bench. And I'm very pleased to say that you understand that and I'm projecting on you, but that that's something you'd like to do.
If I may jump in,
please.
And I'm going to say something about Judge George to see what he would say. Judge George is for a long time, and I don't know if he's still doing it, but he has for a long time, run the drug court. So he's, I go to one day, a friend of mine was graduating. So we go over, and I'm listening to him talk to these people who graduated, and I'm crying.
I'm crying.
And this, and he's so involved with their lives and their success. And it in what he said, and you could see the passion. Now you know Judge George is, he's just very, very passionate about almost everything. And I'm so impressed. But I was more impressed afterwards when we had the luncheon. And he had made all the food for everybody. He made all the food for everybody. So Judge George is
setting the bar.
Yeah, exactly. No, I can't cook. It's takeout with me. But the point I'm saying is he makes a difference there.
Thank you. Thank you, Trina. Yeah, it does make a difference. I mean, I'll continue to advocate for the courts to stay open. I advocate for any court to stay open, frankly, any community court. And I'm not someone that wants to throw money out the window. None of us do. We all want to work as efficiently as we can. But the courts, you know, are a branch of government that gets 1.7% of the state budget. It's not a lot. We're not asking for a lot. But we're asking for enough. And if we want our citizens to succeed, we've got to give them the tools and access to justice as well as tools. So I'm very happy to support you. I've only heard fabulous things about you. You've got not just a beautiful education, you clearly value education at both the public and private level. I hope a fellow like you will talk to people in the public school system. I think it's important for public school kids to see success stories. Them to understand that, you know what, you can go to Harvard, you know, you can do this stuff, because you could have, even after all that great education, you could have just gone in a completely different path that you went on, and thank goodness for the Commonwealth.
Thank you.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I don't have any questions.
Okay.
Thank you. Lengthy conversation.
Thank you.